In source routing, all the information that you need to route the packet is provided as part of the packet itself. So this is rarely used in practice because this places lot of responsibility on the source, because source now has to figure out the entire path. So this is illustrated in this figure. So host A, if it wants to send a packet to host B, will specify what all ports this packet has to go through. So it sends to switch one and it is telling send it out on port one. So this goes like this. Typically this is rotated so that switch two can now act on this field. So this is put at the head. So switch two will know to send it out on port two. And when it comes again, this is rotated. So switch three will know that it has to send it out on port three. So this entire path is specified. As mentioned, this is rarely used in practice because the source, which are typically hosts, have to run the routing protocol, and routing protocols can be rather complex because you are trying to figure out a route when there are millions of hosts out there and nearly thousands of switches that are out there. So where is it used in? Sometimes it is used in the internet core in the routers. So for example, in this case, there are multiple paths in this fashion. So this is all, these are routers, and this is the internet core. And when you are getting packets from this router, you may want to send it on this path. And when you are getting packets on this router, you may want to send it out on this path. If you want to enforce such a path, for example, for load balancing purposes, you need to specify the path to take, and this is done through source routing. I have already mentioned that the source needs to determine the route. This is not practical in many situations. Another characteristic of source routing is that the header can be variable. Why is this the case? Depending on the destination, the path that you are going to take may vary. If really required, this feature can be supported both in datagram and virtual circuit networks, by which I mean that in datagram switching, for example, if the header contains the entire path, you can rely on it and not look at the forwarding table to send this particular packet. So this is a feature that can potentially be supported. And there are two types of source routing. One is called strict, in which the entire path is specified. Another is called loose, where only a subset of the nodes are specified. What do I mean by this is this route will say cover these nodes, but in between what nodes to cover, the path to take is not specified. All it says is this packet has to go through these nodes. Now that we have seen the different switching techniques, let's compare them along different dimensions. The first is the forwarding cost. What do I mean by this? Basically, the effort involved in determining which outgoing port a incoming packet has to be sent on. This cost is rather high for datagram networks because the forwarding table that you consult, this table typically is going to be rather long because it needs to carry the destination addresses of the many hosts that are out there. So the table lookup can be rather expensive in terms of time. On the other hand, in pure circuit switching, if a dedicated wire is allocated to the particular connection, there is absolutely no forwarding cost because the packets will just zip past one hop to the other. The switch, as soon as it receives one bit from the incoming line, can put it out on the outgoing line. In virtual circuit switching, this cost can be very low because you are now going to look only at the connection table. So this address looking in the forwarding table was done as part of the connection setup itself. So these costs do not arise as part of the packet forwarding. They happen during the connection setup. During packet forwarding, you just look at the connection table. Since the number of entries in this is local in scope relative to how many connections are passing through the switch, this can be made very small. As I have already mentioned before, this can also be implemented in hardware, thereby making it rather fast. In terms of bandwidth utilization, the datagram has the highest bandwidth utilization because it employs statistical multiplexing. In pure circuit switching, this is low because you are giving dedicated access to the resources. If a user is not using it, the resources will go waste. In virtual circuit switching, because you're using a combination of circuit switching and packet switching, this can be made flexible. In other words, only for those flows that need reservations, you reserve. For the rest of the flow, they just do statistical multiplexing. In terms of per packet header, which among these three techniques has the lowest overhead? That's right, pure circuit switching, because the packets don't even carry any information as part of it. This is rather high because the address that you use is global in scope, so it will need more number of bits than in virtual circuit where you are using VCI, which is local in scope. In terms of resource reservation, this is not even possible in Datagram. As in pure circuit as well as virtual circuit, this is possible. In terms of initial delay, that is before you send the first packet, the amount of time you have to wait, which has the least amount of initial delay? Right, Datagram, because as soon as you get a packet, you can just forward it because the packet contains enough information to forward the packet to the destination. Whereas in pure circuit as well as virtual circuit, this is high because the connection has to be established before you can send the first packet. So reordering in Datagram, it is possible because, as I said, if some switch failed, you can do an alternate path. Whereas in pure circuit as well as virtual circuit, this does not arise because you are pinning the path. In light of the above, which provides the highest fault tolerance? That's right, Datagram, because you can always find alternate path. Whereas here, if something failed, you have to establish a new connection. So that's with respect to trade-offs. A point I should mention here is even though virtual circuit was proposed as a compromise between pure circuit and Datagram switching, it never really caught on in the internet because this is rather complex. So to this day, there isn't really that much support for real-time applications in the internet, but this is an ongoing research area. So to summarize, there are three types of packet switching that we saw: Datagram, virtual circuit, and source routing. And there are inherent trade-offs between all these techniques. All this is theory. Up ahead, we will see how this theory is applied in practice in the Ethernet standard via Ethernet switching.